چهره‌های سیاسی داخلی و خارجی نظریه‌های گوناگون درباره جنگ به سرکردگی آمریکا در افغانستان دارند. شماره هم به این باورند که آمریکا در جنگ 20 ساله خود در این کشور با شکست مواجه شد و شمار دیگر نیز معکوس آن را دارند. این نظریه‌ها در سطح چهره‌های ارشد کشورها قرار داشته و بیشتر آن سیاسی بودند. اما نظامیان کارکشته و ارشد کشورها که در جنگ افغانستان داخل بودند چی میگویند؟ از نقطه نظر نظامی ماهیت و نتیجه این جنگ چگونه تفسیر می شود؟ شکست و یا هم پیروزی؟ سلام، وقتتان بخیر. جنرال نیک کارتر، رئیس پیشین ستاد ارتش بریتانیا مهمان ما هستند و با ایشان روی جنگ به سرکردگی آمریکا و همچنان نقش بریتانیا در این جنگ و مرور بر مورد مهم دو دهه گذشته نیز خواهم داشت. من حامد بهرام میزبان شما و آقای
General Sir Nick Carter, former Chief Defence of the Staff of the United Kingdom, thank you so much for your time.
It's a pleasure to be with you.
So let's start from here. You push hard for peace talks between Pakistan, Ashraf Ghani's government, and the Taliban, and for a while, it looked as if it would bear fruit, right? What went wrong and why?
I think you have to look at the much broader context before you get into the detail of that particular set of talks, because of course the critical question is whether or not the Ashraf Ghani was a genuinely representative government and in a position to be able to speak on behalf of all of the Afghan people. And I think that was a challenge that had to be thought hard about. So I think you have to look at the broader context for all these things. The reality, I think, was that there was a moment in time where President Ashraf Ghani and Chief of Army Staff General Bajwa could see a way to perhaps create a better relationship and a relationship that would be based upon mutual trust and common understanding that could perhaps lead eventually to an economic relationship. And of course, as we well know from Germany's relationship with Russia prior to the war in Ukraine, the idea of change through trade is a very powerful idea. And I think that was definitely something that was worth developing and building on.
You took Ashraf Ghani to Pakistan and you asked him to go with you and encourage him as he did so. What was Pakistan demanding of him for, what was their demand and why he didn't accept that?
I'm not going to comment on whether he traveled to Pakistan or not. I'll simply talk about the talks because I don't think any of that is particularly relevant. The fact of the matter is that President Ghani had a vision for the region. He used to talk about an Asian roundabout, and he used to talk about the way in which the economies of India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and of course the stars of the north of Afghanistan could be linked together. And that was, I think, a compelling vision in all sorts of ways, because as we all know, if you can create economic dependencies, then that leads to peace. So I don't think I would describe it as demands in any sense at all. I think what both parties were trying to do was to create a relationship based upon mutual trust.
And there was a meeting, trilateral meeting between you, General Bajwa, and Ashraf Ghani, where the meeting's details were very ambiguous till today, but no one knows what happened there. Can you please tell us what you people were really discussed about? And could you agree on some of those issues that you were discussing about?
Now, I beg to differ. If you remember when Prime Minister Imran Khan came to Kabul shortly towards the end of 2019, he and President Ghani announced a shared vision for the two countries. And that shared vision was what was being discussed. So I think there was complete transparency in what was going on.
Right. If I ask you about that, do you believe that Pakistan has some regress in terms of the collapse of the government here in Afghanistan?
Again, I think you have to be very careful how you judge these things. The reality is that what took place in a year ago today was a very tragic event and has led to an awful lot of suffering in Afghanistan, which people like me who've spent a lot of our lives in Afghanistan, have a lot of Afghan friends, feel deeply saddened about. But you have to go back to the beginning. You have to go back to 2001, and you have to look at what took place over a 20-year period to genuinely understand what happened in August last year. And the answer is there are a number of failures. There was a failure, I think, to have a political strategy that could be developed. It was obviously a failure to exclude the Taliban from the Bonn agreements and not to continue a dialogue with the Taliban, which could have led to an inclusive government rather than a government that excluded them. So the lack of a political strategy was fundamental. I don't think the international coalition, which came to help Afghanistan, ever really understood precisely who the enemy was or what the causes of the insurgency were. And of course, it was a failure to build sustainable Afghan security forces. And we all understand that security forces are drawn from the people, and there's therefore inevitably a political connection between security forces and the population. And the reality, I think, was that Afghan forces were not sustainable. And we saw that fundamentally when things unfolded a year ago this month. Then I think, of course, you have to look at the region and you have to look at the way in which different countries played into that and what the policies were towards those countries. And of course, you have to look at economic development and, of course, the tragedy now befalling Afghanistan, where the economy has collapsed, is a good indicator, again, of the lack of a sustainable economy having been built during that 20-year period. So I think it's fundamental that you have to look at the broader context if you're trying to understand the specifics of what occurred a year ago today.
So you were talking about a political structure here in Afghanistan, that it was a mistake, a failure, that Taliban were excluded from the structure in Afghanistan. Was it an intentional move, or the West did not want them to exclude in the government, to include them in the government?
And the answer is I don't know. I wasn't involved myself, so I can't really report on that. I mean, I think what I'm saying is that there would have been merit, no question about it, in all parties and all stakeholders.
As in a military personnel,
getting round the table and discussing what sort of political polity they wanted in Afghanistan. And that was really, I think, one of the first failures. And that would have been a sensible political strategy, perhaps, to have tried to execute from 2001 onwards.
Do you think that the West was thinking that excluding the Taliban will be in their favor because they were thinking that they are powerful, they have the power, and they can fight the Taliban, and they did not take them as reality in the country? Do you think it's because of the power that they had? They did not include Taliban in the political structure?
No, I don't. I think you have to look at the bigger picture. You have to look outside Afghanistan. And the fact of the matter is that the Western intervention into Afghanistan in 2001 was initially about trying to get after Osama bin Laden and al-Qaeda. And of course, it was about regime change. And what then happened over a period of 10 to 15 years was the mission kept evolving. And we went through a process of counterterrorism. We went through a process of nation building. We went through a process of security force assistance. And the mission kept changing. And I think that you have to therefore look at the bigger picture and understand that there are lots of different dynamics going on here. You think how large the international coalition was that came to help Afghanistan in 2001 and how it grew to, I don't know, well over 40 nations being involved. So I think there are a lot of very complicated factors that you have to look at. And that means looking at the bigger picture and understanding both the international politics but also the local politics in Afghanistan.
So you have pointed out to some of the failures, political failures in Afghanistan during the past 20 years, but I want to ask you that since you're a military person, can you tell us that from the military point of perspective, what failures were here in Afghanistan and that led to the collapse?
I mean, you have to recognize that the military is an extension of politics. I'm sure you've read your Clausewitz, the great Prussian general statesman who understood very clearly how warfare evolved from politics. So the answer is there's an inextricable connection between the military mission and the lack of a political strategy. That's the first big point I'd make. Next, I think there was this important point about understanding who the enemy was. And of course, there's a great quote that I often used by a lecturer from King's College London called Antonio Gustozzi, who said of the first 20 years of this century, he said, "Every age has its follies. The folly of our age has been an irresistible desire to change the world without first studying and understanding it." And I think many of the people who perhaps arrived in Afghanistan from the outside world in 2001 and thereafter probably didn't have as good an understanding of the situation on the ground, what the political dynamics were, what the tribal structures were, who the warlords were, what their agendas were. And as a result of that, I think a lot of people probably made assumptions about who the enemy might have been without necessarily genuinely understanding the political dynamics. And that means you probably end up creating enemies from people who might not necessarily need to be your enemies. And then I think the second big mistake I would probably touch on is the building of sustainable Afghan security forces, and in particular, a sustainable Afghan national army. And of course, the Afghan national army, right up until the end, had a critical dependency on international forces for air power, for engineering, for its own air force, for its logistics structure, its sustainability. And once the contractors that provided so many of these functions disappeared, there was no resilience in the Afghan military to be able to do all of these things. So I think I would describe that as a very important and significant mistake that was made.
You're talking about military, a sustainable military structure. We had more than 350,000 of soldiers here in Afghanistan, where they were equipped with all the military things, and they had the support from the Western countries as well. Then what sort of military structure are you talking about? They had everything. They could fight. They were fighting for all along 20 years. They were fighting off what they called enemy. What else? What sort of structure you were talking
about? However big the military is, if it is dependent upon Western support for its logistics, its sustainability, its air force, its maintenance, its engineering, and all of those things, once all of those functions disappear, it doesn't matter how big your military is, it won't survive. You know, militaries are made up of all of those different functions. So it's not just the function that fights. It's the other 70% that makes the military work. You know that old expression, army marches on its stomach. All of those issues are ones that needed to be Afghan-led and Afghan-organized. If they were dependent upon contractors, there was an inevitability that it would collapse once the contractors disappeared.
Sir, right after the collapse of the Republic, you were interviewed and you were asked whether NATO was defeating Afghan war or not, and you replied that it's too early to judge, while your American counterparts accepted that it was a strategic failure. So it's been a year now since the withdrawal of the troops happened, took place in Afghanistan. What's your answer now?
We don't yet know how the Taliban will govern in Afghanistan. We have a much better indication, I think, a year on, as to the way that they are behaving. I think we know, and there was a very effective and well-produced UNAMA report, that's the United Nations mission in Afghanistan, back in June of this year, in which they reported very clearly on the way that the Taliban were detaining people, torturing people, using extrajudicial killings to punish people, that the rights of women and girls were not being held up, and most importantly, the arbitrary way in which they were working meant it was extraordinarily unpredictable as a citizen to be able to live in that country, to understand what the laws really were, to understand what punishments and procedures would follow from that. And of course, you know, so many of the fundamental freedoms that people, you know, by last year were taking for granted, like the right to peaceful protest and dissent, a free media, human rights, all of those sorts of things were under attack. Now, none of that was obvious a year ago, but we now see it. And because of all of that, I think we need to recognize that the current Taliban regime has a distance to go before it's going to be one that is representative of all of Afghans and is governing in a way that is less arbitrary than the way it's governing at the moment. Now, my own personal view, and that is the view, I think, of the owner of your company, is that we need to engage. We need to engage for the sake and future of all Afghans, and engaging with the Taliban means that we must try and encourage the moderate elements in the Taliban to think differently and to think about how they can create an inclusive government and to create a government that governs in a way that is genuinely consistent and predictable and means that those Afghans who want to lead normal lives are able to lead normal lives. So I think it's important that we engage, and that we engage in a subtle way, recognizing with our eyes wide open the things and behaviors that we've seen and the UNAMA report reports on, because then I think, you know, there's a better chance for Afghanistan than might be otherwise.
Do you mean engaging as recognizing the Taliban government as the legitimate one in Afghanistan?
No, that's not what I said. I said engaging. And what engaging means mm-hmm. is that you're going to talk to them. It absolutely doesn't mean that you're going to recognize them. And we can't recognize them given the sorts of behaviors that the UNAMA report in June of 22 reports on. You know, those are not the behaviors of a responsible government and a government that is there for all of its people.
But the Taliban, they rejected the reports that the outside world received. They said that they respected human rights, they are committed to the women's right, whatever the Western countries are asking for. Then why recognition is a problem in between the international community and the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan?
Well, you tell me, you live in Afghanistan. Now, I have not sadly been there for over a year. You tell me who's telling the truth.
Both parties are accusing each other. As far as I got, do you mean recognition is not possible anytime soon of the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan?
Yes, I think it's most unlikely that any Western government, or for that matter, any government in the international community could recognize a government that governs in the way that the UNAMA report is stating. And I also think we mustn't lose sight of the Al-Qaeda connection. And whatever one might or might not think about the so-called deal that was signed at the end of February last year between the United States government and the Taliban, you know, one of the aspects of that deal was that the Taliban would not harbor Al-Qaeda. So the fact that Al-Zahawi, a very, very senior member of Al-Qaeda, was found in Kabul and killed in Kabul, you know, is a very important factor in how we as an international community can respect the Taliban. And if they are going to end up in a position where they are prepared to allow foreign terrorists to reside in Afghanistan, then sadly we're back to where we were in 2001.
Sir, but the thing is that they denied in a statement that they didn't know how he came to Afghanistan, how he resettled here in the country, in Kabul, and they even don't know how this happened, and they denied that. What's happening in between?
Well, that may be their statement, but the fact of the matter is that I think most people know who owned the house in which Al-Zahawi was found.
Do you think Afghanistan is going to could end up as a base for the terrorist group again in Afghanistan?
I don't know. I mean, if the Taliban statement is to be believed, then we must hope that they recognize that Afghanistan must not become a base for international terrorism again. But, you know, if you see it from our perspective, the killing of Al-Zahawi doesn't exactly give you confidence that it's not going to be the case in the future.
But the Taliban, the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan, all the time assures the international community that there is no threat from the Afghan Sultanate of the country. Don't you believe them? Or there's no... The problem is that why the trust is not in between?
As I've said in the answer to the question you posed a moment ago, if you end up seeing a figure like Al-Zahawi living in Kabul, then you've got to ask questions about whether or not the Taliban are serious about preventing international terrorists from residing in Afghanistan.
Does the UK itself feel any threat from the Afghan side?
I mean, the answer is that, you know, if your figure like Al-Zahawi turns up in Kabul, you have to wonder whether other stuff is going on.
So 20 years back, you came here to fight these groups. So what is the next option for the UK and the international community in order to constrain the threats that they feel from the Afghan soil or anywhere in the world?
The point, as I have made a moment ago in an answer to another question, is that I think it's important that we maintain a dialogue with the Taliban government so that we all understand each other's positions. And for the good of the Afghan people, there might be a better chance of the Taliban perhaps governing in a way that we can go along with.
But the Afghans are confused right now, sir. But they don't know. Like, the international community accuses the Taliban, and Taliban in return accuses the international community. But people in between, they're right, are confused what to do, and they don't know what's happening in between.
That is probably the case. But the bottom line is that I'm speaking from an outsider's perspective, and I can only go on the facts as they're presented to me. And based upon those facts, we as an international community would, I suspect, be somewhat suspicious of the Taliban's behavior and the way in which they potentially could be harboring other people like Zahawi.
Some of your contractors, before I go to other questions, some of your contractors who are left here behind in Afghanistan, you were the most critical of that. Is there any plan for them to evacuate them, or that's ended? Now there's no hope for them to leave.
The answer is I don't know. I'm no longer in my former role, and I'm not involved, I'm afraid, in the policy decisions that...
You can suggest something, right, to the government, because you were in a more senior position, military position, that you want to make any suggestion to them.
Well, that's not the way our system works, I'm afraid.
If I ask you about the role of Ambassador Khalilzad in Doha's agreement, how do you assess his role?
I mean, he was the envoy acting on behalf of the American government to try and create a deal with the Taliban.
And was that deal a perfect deal? A good deal? How do you name that?
Well, I think history will be the best judge of that. I mean, I'm on the record as having said that I think he was in a very difficult position, and I think the deal appeared to be much more about a deal for an exit strategy rather than a deal for peace. Now, he would say, I'm sure, that, of course, what he was also trying to achieve was a proper conversation between the government of the Republic and the Taliban, which could lead to a peace deal between those two institutions.
Sir, I had the answer. You said about the prosecutions, arbitrary killings, all those things, that it didn't lead to the recognition. My question is, if you have any message to the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan, how could this secure recognition?
I think they have to govern more inclusively. I think they have to govern in a way that is...
But they say they have an inclusive government. All the tribes are there from the...
If you want me to answer the question, then don't interrupt. What I was going on to say, please, is that first and foremost, they need to govern inclusively for the benefit of all Afghans. And if they do that, there's a reasonable chance that many of the Afghans, I suspect, who have left Afghanistan over the course of the last year might return to the country, which would be very good for the country. Secondly, I think it's important that their governance becomes much less unpredictable, much less arbitrary, so that Afghans genuinely understand where they stand. I think they have got to stop attacking fundamental freedoms. They have got to reinforce the rights of women and girls to be able to go to school and also to use their skills in support of the Afghan population as a whole. And I could go on. And if those sorts of things begin to fall into place, then I think there's a reasonable chance that Taliban government would be recognized by the international community and the world more widely. But I also think we need to acknowledge that we don't want it to become a pariah government like it was before 2001, because that's not going to help anybody. So a dialogue has to continue to try and get these things to be recognized and for mutual understanding to be established.
Okay, if I'm now allowed to ask you a question, sir, that but they consider all these things, that the points that you made, as interfering in the Afghan domestic affairs. What's your response to them now?
They're welcome to their opinion. I've told you what I think mine is. And I'm now going to sign off because I haven't got any much longer, I'm afraid.
General Sir Nick Carter, former Chief Defence of Staff of the United Kingdom, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate that.
Thank you very much indeed. Have a good luck. Bye-bye.
Thank you.